Oh, it slides nicely. So first slide is here. Everything
works. Yes, it works perfect.
Okay, great. Thank you very much, Jacopo. So I'm very glad that I participate here at this conference. I want to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. I'm currently in South Korea, so I'm giving talk like 8 hours ahead from the time you have in France. Still, I'm happy to be here. Today, I'll talk about valley acoustoelectric effect and photon drag in two-dimensional materials in general. And this particular project I did together with my colleagues, with Igor Vakulchik and Vadim Kovalev. Actually, the funny thing about this talk is that you can make it during hours, or at least 1 hour, or you can squeeze it in 15 minutes. So somehow it works good either way. Today it's going to be around 15 minutes. So the general idea of acoustoelectric effect traces back to end of 60s, when there was a paper by Parmenter, who suggested that in 3D, if you launch some acoustic wave, it can drag electrons and thus create electric current. We decided to look at this problem from modern perspective. So we considered novel two-dimensional materials, Dirac materials, like, for example, transition metal decalcogenides. So you make some substrate, you put 2D material on top of that and launch acoustic wave by some IDTs. And then what happens? So here, several interesting effects might take place. One of them is due to special structure of the reciprocal space of the material. In particular, at the minima of the dispersion in K space, there is a trigonal warping, like here in this figure, which actually creates some anisotropy. And it can, in principle, give some components to electric current density if there is a drag. This problem is very similar to the photon drag effect if we have a piezoelectric substrate, because acoustic wave creates some disturbance of this material. There emerges electric field. This electric field starts to act on electrons, and electrons move. We have electric current. In this regard, it's very similar to photon drag effect. To explain in most simple classical way what happens with the system, we can write down full time derivative of the particle distribution function, electron distribution function, and it is equal to the collision integral. Each of the terms here has some meaning. In particular, P dot is the force acting on electrons. Here, there is this electric field which actually drags them. And then R dot is the velocity of particles. This velocity contains regular term due to dispersion, and here emerges the trigonal warping contribution due to special form of the valleys. And also there is the anomalous velocity term in non-centrosymmetric materials due to the Berry phase. All these things are quite known, so I don't want to put more time on that. Once we found the distribution function for electrons, we can put it in classical equation for electric current. So basically what we need is the velocity, the distribution function, and we get the current of electrons in the system. One comment, we should also account for the induced electric field. The acoustic wave propagating along the crystal creates perturbation of electron density, and that's why electrons start to create electric field for electrons. This is also a well-known effect, but it should be accounted for. After the calculations, we found several components. One is classical diffusive drag current. This is known, and it has been reported in other papers on photon drag effect. Our result coincides with this. But also we found the warping related current and the Hall current. This one is due to special form of the valleys in the reciprocal space, and the Hall current due to finite Berry phase. And these two currents can be directed perpendicular to the direction of propagation of the acoustic wave, which is quite interesting. If we parameterize the wave vector of the acoustic wave, so we just take cosine and sine standard form with respect to the x direction in our system, then we can find different angular patterns of this current. These angular patterns are quite confusing, actually, without explanations, but they look nice. This was the main reason why we actually used this way to present the results. But I will try to explain it. So if we take just conventional diffusive drag current, it actually repeats the form of the repeat the direction of the wave vector. So no surprise here, cosine and sine, s in the representation of the wave vector of the acoustic wave drags electron. For x component we have cosine profile, and for y component we have sine profile. Situation is more interesting in the warping component. Here we get cosine of 2 phi and sine of 2 phi coming from the trigonal warping of the valleys. And here you see petals of different form. In particular, the X current can be non-zero, where the conventional current is zero if the angle is pi over 2 with respect to X axis. Also interesting features happens when we speak about the whole current. Here you see that sine and cosine exchange their places. That's why we have the inverse situation to the conventional drag effect. Now, many problems arise. First problem is that net current is zero. We have two valleys, they're connected by time reversal symmetry, and in equilibrium situations, currents from different valleys run in different directions and compensate each other. Another question, it's more problematic actually. Are there other contributions to the warp, to the effect, in addition to the warping current and the Hall current to the Berry phase? And another problem is how to describe the system. So far we have only considered classical regime, distribution function, and so on, which is probably not sufficient. The problem with the net zero current can be solved by, for example, exposing the system to a circularly polarized light. This light creates an imbalance of population between the valleys. Then there is this small region of imbalance, and in principle, we can get finite currents. So our estimations give the conventional current of the order of microamperes and dozens of microamperes, but warping and Hall currents, they are of the order of nanoamperes and tens of nanoamperes, which seems measurable in experiments. But now another problem, other contribution. And it turns out that people are interested in the question for a while. For example, this nice paper by Sinitsyn in 2007 reports that there can be additional contributions to the particle transport due to impurities in the sample. And also I want to draw your attention to very recent work of this year. Actually, it was published 1 or 2 weeks ago by Glazov and Golub, where they consider many different contributions to the photon drag effect of electrons in 2D materials. In particular, in addition to the anomalous velocity term to the Berry phase, we should also track the behavior of electron due to side jump and skew scattering contributions. And these effects are also known for some time. Okay, anomalous velocity can emerge in any sample, not the sample without impurities or with impurities, but in realistic samples, of course, all the three regimes might take place. And how do they interplay? What will be the actual reason of the Valley Hall effect? This is a question. So we decided to see what will happen in non-equilibrium situation. We have our setup, two-dimensional material and substrate, two leads, to apply some constant voltage or electric field to the sample, and then we expose it to the electromagnetic field of light to pump the system. And we decided to go through non-equilibrium Keldysh diagram technique to describe the system. Conventional Hamiltonian, then two fields, one pump field, one drag field. Then we use standard formula for generalized conductivity, which connects the vector potential with the current, electric current in the system. And finally, the task comes down to finding the sort of dressed Green's function of electrons, which accounts for impurities, which accounts for the pumping by light. Then if you found this generalized conductivity QXY, we can get the whole conductivity usual conductivity here by a standard formula. It looks quite standard, but the problem here is that once you start plugging in impurity lines and different field lines, you die in combinatorics, because in general there can be hundreds of diagrams up to 1,000. And how to treat them, it's not that clear to start. So once we started to play with this, it became some sort of nightmare where you put different lines in different places. So these are all Feynman diagrams for currents, and there is a lot of them. Okay, some ancient wisdom helps. At least we can sort out some diagrams which are initially smaller by magnitude. Still, it's quite a complicated problem. Situation is a bit easier with just anomalous contribution due to the anomalous velocity term, because here you can actually neglect impurity lines in some to some extent at least. But even here, one should treat it carefully, especially if you want to account for side jumps, skew scattering. But skew scattering also can be different, and side jumps give many new diagrams. However, after some working, it's possible to distinguish between principal contribution, especially if we find some general way how to write down the green function of electron dressed by light and with account of impurity lines also. Then we come down to just small stack of diagrams, the anomalous contribution here, then the side jump diagrams here with different lines, and also there comes in play the X diagrams and the sort of Mercedes-Benz diagrams or Y diagrams like this. And this problem becomes easy to calculate, in fact, after all this stuff. The final results look quite small. It's not some huge formulas.
To go.
Yeah. I'm counting time. Don't worry. I'll finish in time. So we get quite similar formulas for the berry phase contribution, side jump contribution, and the X skew scattering. All these formulas are connected with the photoinduced density of electrons, so density of photoexcited electrons. We found this formula, and so now we know what will be the actual density of electrons due to the pump of the system by light in this regime. And this NE comes actually in all the formulas. The interesting thing here is if you sum up three of the contributions, they nearly cancel each other out, especially in a realistic regime, where the interband recombination is bigger than the scattering on impurity time, then here in this term we get nearly zero, and three terms cancel out, but one remains due to the Y skew scattering of electrons. This is a little bit questionable explanation, because in fact this all effect, this Valley Hall effect, is a combined effect of all these terms. And what cancels out to what is at least not very clear to me. So these terms sort of cancel each other out nearly, but still combined effect is non-zero. So maybe it's one of the interpretations how to put it. Still, the final effect is non-zero. It's proportional to the density of photoinduced electrons, and we have calculated it here. To conclude, I want to first of all draw your attention to these recent works. One work I already mentioned during the talk. This work discusses all the relevant contribution to Valley Hall effect. We also considered it in the situation of non-equilibrium when we have this pumping of the sample by external light, and our paper is on the archive now. In general, I want to say that acoustoelectric effect and photon drag effect can be quite similar if we speak about acoustic waves propagating on the piezoelectric substrate. Then we deal with some electric field acting on electrons, and these effects become similar to each other. And as a result of some calculations, it's possible to find what will be the situation in non-equilibrium case when the sample is driven by external pump. So with that, I want to thank you for your attention.
Thanks a lot, Ivan. Great talk. The questions from the audience? So no raised hands. Good. So I have the curiosity of knowing how much this effect is limited to these two-dimensional systems. Or can you think of using something similar, for instance, on the edge of more complicated three-dimensional topological materials?
Well, in short, I actually don't know what will happen in 3D. At least I don't have intuition what will happen there. But perhaps there can be something similar, because if you have some breaking of the symmetry, if you have some special structure, then in principle there can be similar contributions. I don't see at least why there shouldn't be an effect in 3D. But I don't deal with 3D usually. And there you are going to deal with three-dimensional integrals, which makes it very hard. So,
good. Thanks, sir.
Excuse me, I got a question.
Okay. Okay, go for it, Salvatore.
Yes. Hello. Excuse me. My question is very simple, and it is, which is the special role for TMDs? Do you need specifically TMDs for this kind of effects, or I don't know? The question is, do TMDs play a special role for this kind of effects or no?
Okay, actually, yeah, it's a good question. In principle, for the if you remove trigonal warping, and yeah, then you don't need any special material. It can be actually in any 2D material. Also, you need to have finite Berry phase for the anomalous contribution. And I think the needed property is non-centrosymmetric of the material. So it shouldn't be centrosymmetric. Then you have finite Berry phase effect and you start to get anomalous contribution, but the impurity scattering should be everywhere actually. So I think effect takes place in any structure.
Okay, thanks a lot. Other questions? So no more questions. So let's thank Ivan again. And let's move on to the next.